Imagine booking your dream holiday in the Caribbean. Turquoise water, white sand, and instead you're hit by a wall of rotting seaweed.
Nothing beats a Jet 2 holiday. And right now, you can save £50 per person.
Scientists are calling it a seaweed tsunami. Right now, a vast belt of brown algae is drifting across the Atlantic. It's so massive you can see it from space. And every year it slams into the Caribbean like a tidal wave of slime. These waves of Sargassum are washing ashore in record-breaking amounts, smothering beaches, wrecking tourism, and choking coastal ecosystems. But why now? Is it fueled by pollution, driven by warming oceans, or something else entirely? In this video, we'll unpack the science behind this Sargassum invasion, what it means for our oceans and our planet, and why some researchers think this stinky mess might actually hold hidden opportunities. This is Sargassum, a distinctive type of brown seaweed that's become a serious headache on beaches across the Gulf of Mexico and the Caribbean. Why does it suddenly appear in such massive quantities? Sargassum grows in the open ocean, drifting together to form enormous floating islands. Since 2011, almost every spring and summer, a vast bloom has been forming in the central Atlantic Ocean. These patches of floating brown weed have stretched all the way from the coast of West Africa to the Gulf of Mexico, in what scientists now call the Great Atlantic Sargassum Belt. This belt of drifting seaweed gets expanding year by year. In March 2023, researchers measured the largest amount of Sargassum ever recorded for that month. And eventually, much of it ends up washed ashore, piled up on some of the most pristine beaches in the world. So why are we seeing such a dramatic surge in growth? Sargassum is a genus of brown seaweed that floats freely, forming immense mats or islands at the sea's surface. Together with the currents of the North Atlantic, these mats have given rise to a unique ecosystem known as the Sargasso Sea. There are many different species of Sargassum, but they all share common features. One of the most important is their ability to float independently without being anchored to the seabed. How does that work? If you look closely, the body of the seaweed, called the tholos, has a stem-like structure with flat, leaf-like blades growing from it. Along those stems, you'll find small berry-like nodules known as pneumatocysts. These are little gas-filled bladders like tiny balloons that act as built-in floats, allowing the Sargassum to ride at the surface of the ocean. In the water, Sargassum often collects into thick mats that can stretch over wide areas. Another striking trait of Sargassum is its method of reproduction. It can reproduce both sexually and asexually, giving it the ability to spread and colonize quickly. Under the right conditions, it can double its mass in less than 20 days. Combine this with its efficiency at absorbing nutrients and you have a recipe for rapid growth. These traits are what fuel the immense blooms we've been seeing in the past decade, and they underpin the expansion of the Great Atlantic Sargassum Belt. Until 2011, Sargassum wasn't something most Caribbean beaches had to deal with. It largely stayed within its traditional range, the Sargasso Sea. But that year, vast mats of it began appearing far further south in the central Atlantic, and from there washing up on beaches across the eastern and southern Caribbean. By 2018, these mats had grown into the largest macroalgae bloom in recorded history. The belt stretched some 8,850 kilometers from the central Atlantic and the Caribbean all the way across to West Africa and the Gulf of Mexico. This colossal belt of seaweed brings both benefits and problems. On the positive side, it serves as a critical habitat for marine life. Tiny fish, juvenile turtles, even this little fellow here, all rely on the floating habitat for survival. Sargassum also sequesters carbon, drawing it out of the atmosphere. But the downsides are severe. When the seaweed washes ashore in large amounts, it smothers beaches, suffocates coastal ecosystems, and disrupts industries that depend on the sea. In the tropical heat, the weed quickly rots, releasing gases like hydrogen sulfide, which smell of rotten eggs and make life unpleasant for local residents and tourists alike. The blow to tourism has been particularly harsh. Tourism is the economic lifeblood of the Caribbean. And since the first bloom in 2011, resorts and coastal communities have been struggling with wave after wave of seaweed arrivals. Instead of postcard-perfect beaches, visitors are met with stinking piles of decaying algae. By 2018, the estimated cost of clearing sargassum across the Caribbean reached about $120 million. As that figure doesn't even include the huge losses from cancelled trips, empty hotels, and struggling local businesses. So why is this happening? Scientists have identified several key factors that contribute to the formation of these massive blooms. First, there's the seed population. Large patches of sargassum from one year often survive the winter, acting as the starting point for next year's growth. Second, nutrient upwelling along the coast of West Africa in winter provides a food boost that helps fuel early growth. But perhaps the most significant factor is the Amazon River. Research suggests that fertilisers used in farming across the Amazon basin are being washed into the river, carried out to sea, and feeding the sargassum blooms. These nutrient-rich waters act like fertiliser on a global scale. Environmental degradation in the Amazon appears to be creating a ripple effect that extends thousands of miles away into the Atlantic Ocean. Scientists are only beginning to grasp the full scale of these links, but it's clear that what happens on land doesn't stay on land, and to fully understand the dynamics, further research is urgently needed. Yet even in this crisis, there are potential upsides. One suggestion for dealing with the excess seaweed is to sink it in deeper water, locking its carbon away from the atmosphere and potentially buying time in the fight against climate change. At the same time, sargassum is being explored as a valuable resource. It can be processed into compost, converted into biofuel, used as livestock feed, or fed into the chemical processes behind cosmetics, medicines, and health supplements. It might even provide material for building products like paper, boards, or bioplastics. There is a caveat, though. Sargassum can accumulate heavy metals, which makes some applications risky. Still, innovation continues. Communities have begun experimenting with smaller-scale uses, like turning sargassum into bricks for low-cost housing, using it in wastewater treatment, or piloting it as a renewable fuel source. So next time you come across piles of sargassum on a white sandy beach, remember this: it is more than seaweed. It's also a resource, a signal about the health of our planet, and maybe even part of the solution to a circular and more environmentally friendly economy. Just don't forget, it can be unbearably smelly too. We've seen how seaweed can pile up like a tsunami, but what about the waves themselves? What are the biggest ones ever recorded? Find out in this video. And if you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing. And let me know in the comments what I should talk about next.